guys.
Hey, Marcus. Fill in the blank, we are studying the book of
Philippians.
Cool. Wednesday nights, you know, we're going really through the passages kind of more in depth. And then on Sunday mornings, we're kind of going topically a little bit of what Philippians covers. And so we have, I call him the Reverend. Pastor Bob is here to speak. What's your verse again?
Philippians 3.
Philippians 3:20.
Our citizenship is
in heaven. So if you have your Bibles, you can even follow along there. But Pastor Rob, you guys know who he is. He's a pastor, so I'm just going to let him
play. All
right. Three people are excited.
You know, our citizenship is in heaven. What I want to really talk about today is the first thing about is how do we live as citizens of heaven? You know, really, as Christians, we live in two worlds. We live in this world, this physical world that you see. We also live in the spiritual world. And for all of us, it's hard to understand what it really means to live in the spiritual world. We recently had a guy, any of you went to church last week and heard the heavenly man guy from China. I mean, talk about a guy who knew the spiritual realm. Tell one story about him. He was a Chinese Christian. He was sharing the faith and got thrown in prison, and he was in prison for about 13 years. Well, one of the, you know, when he was in prison for being a Christian, they broke his legs and sledgehammered and things like this. Well, one day he's just at the bottom of the pits, and God speaks to him and says, "Today's the day you're getting out of prison." The guy says, There's four doors between here and the outside, I'll never get out of this prison." God says, "No, you will." And so he tries the cell door, goes open, and then he goes past the next row of guards, and he just walks past them, and then another row of guards. Just walks. And finally, they're changing the guards at the end, so there's like 100 guards, and he just walks out, and then Jesus put a taxi there waiting for him. And he got in the taxi and left, and he was gone for about 3 or 4 more years, sharing Christ with other people. But he was a guy who understood what it really means to be a citizen of heaven. Now, when I was your age, I didn't go to church. I never went to church. My family didn't go to church. I didn't understand. Then I became a Christian through a series of events. People prayed for me and everything right as I graduated from high school. And so I was coming to church. I didn't know a single song. I didn't know the Lord's Prayer. I didn't even know if I was singing it in the right key either. Any song. All the ones that he said, I didn't know either. And so I had no idea what it really meant to walk as a citizen of heaven, to be a citizen of Jesus Christ. But a lot of you have probably studied in your classes at school what it means to be a citizen of the United States. You're born in the United States, you're naturalized. Are all of you citizens of the United States? You're here, I think, pretty much. Has anybody ever been naturalized into the United States, come in through another way than birth? Maybe? I don't know. But, you know, when we're as citizens of the United States, we have certain rights. The right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We have a right that we're not going to be under a dictator or a king, that we can be the government for the people, by the people, you know? That type of thing. And so we live in a country, but we also have protections that are given to us from our government. Rights, we have protections, we have a constitution, we have a legal system, we have military forces that protect us. Then we also have responsibilities as citizens of the United States. And, we have responsibilities to follow our constitution and law, participate in the voting system, to be productive citizens, and to serve when called. And some of you may, at some point in your life, have to serve. And one of the things, if you get older, have you ever had jury duty, Corey? Yes, jury duty. You're called upon by your country, the government to serve. I've done that too, we had jury duty. Things like that. So we're called to do something as citizens, as we are called to do something as citizens of the kingdom of heaven. And what I'm going to do today is I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about this. But there's two verses around the key verse today. The key verse today is our citizenship is in heaven. These are verses around around it because it speaks about conflict. There's two different worlds, right? And this is the other one. There's the people who have the citizenship in heaven and eternal life, and then there's this other group. Their destiny is destruction. This is verse 19. Their God is their stomach. In other words, they're just pursuing things that make them feel good in their life. And their glory is their shame. Their mind is on earthly. So you have people whose mind is on earthly things. Then the contrast to that is that our citizenship is in heaven, where we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power enables us to bring everything under His control and transform our lowly bodies so that we might be like His glorious bodies. So, really, there's two different groups of people. You know, really, in the world that we all live in, there's a lot of tensions and pressures that are on us all the time. And what our values really should be. And we put so much emphasis on how we look and what we have and communication through our electronic devices and eventually getting the right education, the right job, and these types of things. You know, in the ancient world, Israel didn't have a king at first. God was their king. And then what did they do? They wanted new king. They wanted a real king. So they chose the best looking and tallest guy, a guy named Saul. But he turned out actually to be a guy with demons. So he was kind of a weird king, actually, all of a sudden. But we choose things like that, the ways of the world that seem so cool to us, and yet are not cool to God. The question I want to just present to you to think about as we talk about citizenship in heaven is how are you really going to live your life? Are you really going to live your life for God? Or are you going to live your life for the things of this world? And so what we're pointing to the scripture is that understand what our citizenship in heaven really means. And I've got like 10 things, so I'm going to say them kind of quick, really. Our citizenship in heaven begins with the new birth through Jesus Christ. He gives us new life. So that's the beginning point. And maybe all of you have that, and maybe all of you don't. Maybe you were like me when I was your age and didn't know anything about God. And I thought I was a good person and probably get to heaven because I was as good as everybody else. And I found out it's not just our goodness that gets us to heaven. It's our faith in Jesus Christ and repenting of our sinfulness because we all are sinful. It's by grace that we're saved through faith, not that of ourselves. And so the first thing in order to really experience citizenship in heaven and knowing what it's about is you have to have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. The second thing that I began to see, though, once I had that relationship, like I was telling you, I go to church, I didn't know any song. I had no idea what to do. I'm supposed to be a citizen in heaven. I'm supposed to live for God. What do I do? I began to discover that there's a lot of promises in the scripture that I'm forgiven, that I'm a new creation, the old things have passed away, that I've been transferred from darkness into the kingdom of light, that you know, it's hard to imagine this, but God actually looks at us through Jesus Christ as holy and blameless. You think of your life, you think of how bad we are and how much we sin, that He can look at us for that, that He gives us forgiveness for our sins, and He will continue to give forgiveness for our sins as we repent. In Colossians 3:3, it says, you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. So that when you see Him, when He appears, you will also be like Him before. For it shows us before the beginning of creation, the holy and blameless in sight. Ephesians 1, verse 4. And so, a part of the Christian life is, and a part of really living as citizens of Him, is finding out what you have in Jesus. You have everything with Jesus Christ. But you know what we think of the world? We think what the world gives us is everything. And God says, what I have is everything. So what I'm going to say about the whole thing today is, are you really willing to make God everything in your life? Because that's what the Christian life is all about. The thing that I discovered in my journey with God, And I see this in a lot of you, that you really put a strong emphasis on being in community, being in fellowship, being with other Christians. I know a lot of you are talking about Bible studies you're in or leading, you know, groups on Wednesday, as you're going down together, serve, doing all these things together. And so community is one of the essential parts, being with other Christians. And what I found that I was really good for me when I just come over to be a Christian is to be around people who are further along in their faith than I was. And so I would try to go to these people, and I would actually try to ask them questions about how they live the Christian life out. I learned to pray better by being around people who were seasoned in their prayer. So I encourage you to do that, to seek out fellowship, not just fellowship like this here. Like we had our head of our ushers come here and say, you know, I need lots of ushers. Well, you know, if you be an usher for even just once a month or one service or something like that, you mix it up with a different group. You kind of get out of your comfort zone, you know, being around people like yourselves, and you stand up and get to know adults in a good way. So I encourage you to think about that. Think about continuing in your community and growing. You know, when we're part of the kingdom of God, we're chosen for a purpose. And what is the purpose in your life? In Ephesians 2:10, it says, "Well, God's workmanship created in Jesus Christ for good works." I love this passage of scripture that says that we're to share the sweet aroma of Jesus in every place we go. That Jesus can actually manifest himself to you and your needs rather than you. Have you ever actually prayed that? That God somehow affect my friends, somehow affect them through me as I'm available to you. So we're chosen with a purpose. And that's one of the things that I thought was really great about Christianity for me, is I had an eternal purpose. Have you thought about that? Things that you do have an eternal impact. I'll never forget, I was scared to death to tell anybody else about God, and then a lot of my friends were telling everybody about God, and so this girl came up to me, she started questioning me about it, and I told her what I knew, and I said, well, if you'd like to pray, you can, and she said, yeah, I really would. I said, are you kidding? You really will? You want to receive Christ right now? She said, yes. And she right there, and she was just afraid to receive Christ. That's God. That is God's plan. And we're talking about citizenship in heaven. You know, pray that God will give you eyes to see what he is doing around you and to be able to join him in whatever that activity might be. One of the keys that I have found to really living out citizenship in heaven is found in Hebrews 12:1-2. It says this, therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, since all sorts of people are surrounding us, people in the past, all the Christians around all the time, all the people around right now, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every sin and the things that so easily entangle us. And let us run with endurance the race set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus. You know, when I became a Christian, I cussed something. You know, I said, you know, it doesn't seem like that's quite the thing that you should do as a Christian. But have you ever tried, you know, and I know probably a lot of you don't cuss at all, and others have probably did, but have you ever tried to stop cussing? You know, I was trying to, like, let's go, and when I found the things that sins in my life, it was not putting forth an effort to try to do something that would counteract the sin that was in my life so much as really following Jesus Christ. So the more I focused on Christ, the more I found my language changed. The more I pursued him, and you know, then, you know, really a short period of time, because I was pursuing Jesus Christ. And so if there's one principle you can get in living as a citizen of the kingdom, it's to focus your eyes on Jesus all the time. To be thinking about him. And I found it really weird because I thought you'd just kind of like think of Jesus on Sunday. And I was in philosophy class, and I remember this really well in college. I was in philosophy class, and what does this have to do with anything? And then all of a sudden, I started figuring out how what they were talking about in philosophy hit what I was talking about learning in the Bible. And it came down to the final exam, and we had to state our philosophy live, and I thought, okay, I'm going to get an F, because I'm going to write that on the bridge. Because my professor had been in the hit review, and he was amazing. And so I go, well, I'm going to flunk this one. So I wrote out, because he won my philosophy of life. And so I wrote my philosophy of life, one of the things I've learned in philosophy. I got my test back, I expected to flunk. And he says, you're the only person in the class to actually state your philosophy of life. You get a B+. And I thought, that is amazing. You know, would say that. But, you know, we have these decisions to make. Are we going to do what God wants us to do? Or are we going to do what we want? And I'm encouraging you to do what God wants you to do. You have eyes to see what He wants you to do. And in Colossians 3:2, it talks about focusing your mind on the things of God. And the way we do this, to me, is we spend time with God daily, quiet time. We realize that God actually wants to talk to us 24/7. And here again, that's what I was doing in the last few days. The seventh thing that I wanted to say to you, and try to get all the points as we go through the past through these, is how do we stay pure? We stay pure by reading the Word of God and letting the Word of God transform us. In Psalm 119, How can a young person keep pure? By living according to my word. Psalm 119:10. I've hidden my word in my heart that I might not sin against you. You know, our minds and the way we think need to be changed. And that's how we understand more of what it means to be a citizen of heaven. God's mind becomes our mind through the word of God. And so one of the keys that I found is I really started reading the Bible. I started reading the Bible all the time. You know? And this is what the crazy Chinese guy said. I don't know if you even caught this last week. But he was saying, well, yes, once I became a Christian, I started memorizing a chapter of the Bible every day. Did any of you catch that? What he said, memorize a chapter every day. I memorize a verse every day, more or less a chapter. But I got the point, and I think this is the point for all of you. If you really read the Bible, take care of your time in it, it will transform your life, it will transform your mind. You know, another thing that I found is that we need to guard our hearts, because there's all sorts of creepy influences that are around us all the time. And we see all these types of things on TV, and pray that God would guard our hearts, and that we can truly hear God's Holy Spirit speaking to us above what we hear in the world. And there's no greater thing when you discover that God is really needed. And I remember, I want to thank, you know, some of you probably don't even know this, but I, for 25 years, I was easily here. So that's before here was here. I had the answers. And during that time, I had note cards, and I write all the students' names on the note cards. And I pray for these note cards. Fireplace. I don't know if any of you ever really prayed like for 200 people. You know, like look like 200 people, that's a lot of people. And so I just, but there's sometimes, if you ever pray for something and you just wonder, am I good? And then I got to the point one day I was just praying through these things, and I was like, I think I'm just going to throw all these cards in the fire. Nothing's happened. And I said, well, there's things happening too. But then I get to this one note card, and I go, I'm supposed to call this guy right now. And this is like 3:30. So I call this guy, and I didn't really even know this guy. So I call this guy, and he goes, what are you doing calling me, you know? I said, well, what? Are you getting upset about something? Is there something? He says, well, I don't know how to tell you this, but I was just getting ready to commit suicide. You know, God really, really, truly can use you in ways we never expect. And so what I'm saying to you, as citizens of heaven, we have an opportunity to make a big difference in this world if we just start listening to God and let Him take our hearts and let Him lead us. And the fact is that we are in a struggle between spiritual forces that are working on us all the time. And there are people, the devil is trying to knock you off path, and, you know, and he will if you don't fight him with the Holy Spirit within our lives. And, you know, what God really wants us to do, he wants to give us eyes to see or to join God in his work. And there's a lot of opportunities around us all the time. You know, a lot of you sit here and you hear people that have, you know, told them all these experiences they've had, talking to others about God, or they got knowledge. And I guarantee you, if you pray, you say, "Here I am, God, use me," he literally will. And you never know where it will take you. You know, sometimes you look at someone like me as a pastor and think, well, he was that way. He was off. I wasn't that way, okay? I didn't. You know, my family were alcoholics. There's nobody in my family that's been a Christian. And when God gets a hold of you, you change. And my identity in high school, I was the rest of it. I was just a mean person. I like to hurt people. And the rest of it, I mean, God changed my attitude. So what I'm saying for you today is pursue that citizenship of heaven and let God use your life in mighty ways. And you know what will happen to you? You'll come out like Pastor Neil. Sometimes you'll have to sacrifice for your faith. But the sacrifice is so important because you're going to be changing lives for eternity. And God is calling some of you in this room right now to be people who will actually make disciples of others. That you will reach out to people even your age and help them to grow in their faith. So that is what I'm praying for you. And so I'm asking you today to take that citizenship in heaven seriously, and that your life could be one of God's miracles. And that that you will help others. Some of you think that's impossible, and some of you someday will be sitting in my position right here giving speeches like this. So I am praying this for you. It's fun, you know, because I've known, you know, I knew some of your parents before you were born, before they were even dating, and many of you have grown up. And the thing I want to say for you all that are here today, I believe God has great plans for you. Just give him the opportunity. It's amazing. Heavenly Father, I thank you for our citizenship in heaven that is by faith in Jesus Christ. And I pray that we begin to live like it, because we see around so many people living only for this life, a life that will end soon, and a life that may be spent in eternity apart from you. I pray, God, for us that we would take that eternal life seriously, that we would take our calling seriously, that each of us in this room had gifts that would be used by you, and that we are, each person here is very unique in that gift to us. And so, God, I pray that for this group of people, that they would become even more committed to giving their hearts fully to you, saying to you, "Here I am, God, send me." And I pray these things for each person here, that your spirit can look upon them and
Thanks, Bob. Appreciate it.
All right. Remember that if you can go to Revolution, come find Olivia. And then also don't forget that this Wednesday, go to Home Churches. Be there. Have fun. Awesome. Cool. Get out of here.